Hey, what's up? In this video, we will build an entire Ableton set from start to finish. So let's go ahead and get started.
All right, welcome back. This is the big one. This is the one where we are going to put together an entire set based on the work we've done in the previous videos with putting together first a multitrack from multitracks.com and setting it up for my Ableton method, and then going in with ProPresenter 7, setting the song up with slides and then automating those slides in Ableton. So if you haven't seen those two videos, you're going to want to go back and do that first. If you have and you have made it this far, congratulations. We are going to do the thing now. So if you're feeling pretty confident, you might want to just, like, you know, relax a little because it's going to get harder. But it's not impossible. So here we go. Let's get rolling. Now, in order to build a Sunday set, I start from a completely blank Ableton file. So that's where we are right now. I've just opened it up. And if you were to do that yourself, you would just go new live set and then in you go. And from there, the first thing we're going to do is we're going to say goodbye to session view and get over here into arrangement view. Now, what I do is I'll go ahead and delete these couple of tracks right here, and I'll explain why as we're starting to set these things up. The master is going to be set, as we did before, to 1 and 2. That way, for most people who are simply running a TRS 1/8-inch jack out of the side of your computer, and you're going to pick up the cues and the clicks through channel 1 and then everything else that comes through the house in channel 2, that's going to be done exactly the same way as we did each individual song. So the next thing we're going to do is we're going to come up in here to this MIDI track that's already set, and we're going to Command R. Remember, Command R is rename. And I am going to call this MIDI cues. I'm also going to make it bright yellow. You can kind of do it your way. This helps me because they're easy to spot from the stage, and that's just the way I like to do it. Now, as far as this next one, you can make that. I mean, that's the same color as I use for slides, so I usually use something else, like maybe a blue. Let's find something nice. There's a nice one. How about it? Easy to see. So we're going to Command R that, and we're going to call this pad, because 9 times out of 10, when we start a brand new set, we're going to start that thing with a pad. So that I like to put that up top. And you can either use one continuous track for all the pads in your entire set, or you can make a pad track before or after each song. And I'll show you what I mean by that as we move forward. As for now, the MIDI cues, let's actually start there. In Bill's MIDI cues project, which you can find a link to in the description, and you can find it in all the other videos as well, we have all these cues that we have used. So far, we've learned how to use the slides for ProPresenter, the playlist, which calls up the certain song, and we'll be using that one specifically this time. We learned how to use markers so that we could put the markers in for our songs, because we also learned that our locators were not going to come over when we build a set. So you're going to see how that works in a little bit. We learned how to use tempo, and we did not get to these, though. These are kind of my favorite creations. I use these all the time, and these are incredibly helpful. So I'm going to explain what each of those is, how to get it into the set, and how to get it working with the set. These are preset with notes, MIDI notes and intensities that I have chosen. You can always change these if they're stepping on some of your other cues. And if you have questions about that, you can always ask. Just put it in the comments. I'm happy to come back and give you an answer. But and this isn't the main one, but these are the main three that we're going to use. So I'm going to bring them onto the timeline and just show you how they work. The first one is going to be a click toggle. And I'm just going to pinch out so you can see this whole cue, and so it's easy to work with. The click toggle, as of right this second, it's just a note. It doesn't do anything until you tell it what to do. But what we're going to do is we're going to let Ableton listen to that note, and then we're going to tell it what to do when it hears that note. So if that doesn't have you completely caught off guard, let's go ahead and try that real quick. So the way to do that is we're going to go into MIDI mode, and that's done right over here. You're going to click MIDI. And then what I want to do is I want this cue to toggle the click on and off, the Ableton click. And there are lots of reasons why you might need to do that in different sets. A couple of those just right off the bat. Number one, you don't want a click going if you don't need a click going. So if you've got like a pad going and somebody's just kind of playing some ambient sounds during hosting or something like that, you don't want the annoyance of a click unless you're trying to prep for the next song, in which case you might want to turn it on. But 9 times out of 10, you don't want that on. So we're going to turn it off during those times. Another time that you're going to want to turn it off, because remember, this click is going to do whatever we're telling it to do in our tempo track. So each song has its individual tempo track, and if something happens that makes that song deviate, for example, a song that slows down and drags the click like near the end or something like that, then your two clicks are going to be out of sync. We have the snappy sub click that comes with each song, and then we have the Ableton click. Some of you may never use the Ableton click. I prefer it because I think that beep click is louder. It's easier to hear. It gives you a solid click, and then it lets you use that other one as a sub click. So all that aside, what you would have to do in that case when a song starts dragging and and the custom snap click that comes with the song is going to drag right along with it because it was designed that way, all you have to do is put this bad boy up in the MIDI cues lane, and it will turn off the Ableton click while that's happening. And then you can just crank it back up when everything gets back the way it's supposed to be. So here's what we're going to do. We've again, to recap, we have hit this MIDI button. That's got us ready to start listening and assigning. So now everything that can be MIDI assigned, and there's so many things that can, they've been kind of grayed out for you, or blued out, or oranged out, or whatever. So here they are all available. And this is the MIDI note and the control. So what we're going to do is we're going to start the track going. And then once I do that, while we're waiting to get to this note, I'm going to hit the button that I want that note to control. So since I want to, here's my path, right? I'm going to click here, and then I'm going to immediately come up and I'm going to click this metronome button. And then as soon as the playhead hits that note, it's going to lock it in right over here as being the click toggle. Before we do that, I am going to, let's come out of MIDI mode real quick, and I'm going to actually set the IAC driver to be the output for this channel, because that's the way that this works. Again, if you need to know how to use the IAC driver, there's a million places you can learn that. Loop Community is a good one. They have a good video on that. Otherwise, ask me in the comments. I can help you with it too. It's not a big deal. So let's go back into MIDI mode. We'll come back here, give it a little bit of a running start. As soon as I click this, I'm going to hit the metronome and click. And now as soon as it hears that click toggle note, watch what happens over here. Boom. See? So now we're done. I'm going to hit spacebar and stop. We have just programmed the click toggle to turn the click on and off. Now let's test it. I'll just bring this down, and we'll make a couple of instances of it. I'm going to Command C to copy it, and Command V to paste it back. As we begin, you're going to hear nothing. But when we hit that, it's going to turn the click on. Hear that? And now when we hit it again, it's going to turn the click back off. Okay, success. That is loaded and ready. We can delete both of these off of here. It's fine. They're already saved in the set and ready to do their job. Now, same is going to go with loopback, but I'm going to show you that in a little while because I think it'll be easier for me to do that when we have some locators. Stop is not hard, okay? That one I've made red, and I also have this map to the note G8 because G8 is kind of a... for instance, Loop Community's pedal that they have, the Looptimus, it automatically sets G8 as the global stop. So I use that for stop as well. There'll be times when we need to use this and sometimes when we don't. So let's go ahead and hit MIDI again. This time we're going to do the same thing. I'm going to get a little running start. Then I'm going to come up here and hit the stop button. And as soon as Ableton hears that note, that G8, it's going to assign it to stop. So here we go. Stop. And... boom. See? Note G8, transport, stop. Okay. I'm hitting spacebar, coming out of MIDI mode. Now we can delete this. So now we have two of our three main MIDI cues assigned. When we get a little bit further down the road, we'll do the rest. All right. So another thing I'm going to do is for this one, we're going to drop this pad in. This pad is going to go to the external out of 2 because it's going to be heard by people. It's not going to be in ears. So the pad's going to be heard. I personally, I've used different pads, and the ones that that I typically use, or church front pads are good. This is Jake Gosselin. He has a good channel that you should dial into. There's a lot to learn there. And I use the wave versions of the pads. They're a little bit larger, but they're just higher quality, and you want to always crank waves out if you can. If all your tracks are MP3, you may not want to worry about that, but in this case, we're gonna go with that. So before we do that, we're going to figure out what is our set going to actually be, because that is going to inform which pad I decide to use. And I picked three songs for us. We're going to open with Only King Forever in the key of C, and it's 138 beats a minute. We are going to then move to Canvas and Clay, which is in key of B, and it's 72 beats a minute. And then we're coming back to the key of C for Stand in Your Love. So so the first song we do will be in C. And for that reason, what I want to do is I want to open up with a pad in C. So let's get that going. Let's take the C, right? You got all these are up semitones. You got all the ones you need. And this warm pad in the key of C is actually a very nice pad. I use it all the time. Now, it's dropped in there. I just dragged it over and I put it on the very beginning of the timeline. Now what I'm going to do is right-click right here at this beginning, and I'm going to select Add Locator. And I like to keep these, I like to call this zero, because song one for me is going to be number one. So I'm going to hit zero and a little hyphen, and I'm going to call this Start. That way, and so now I have a locator. My first locator is Start, and this is where I'm going to start. While I'm at it, I can hit this little over here. I can hit key, and this assigns MIDI the same as the MIDI button does, but you can assign it to actual keys on your keyboard. So I'm going to click. See how that's yellow now? That means I can assign it. I'm going to click that, and then I'm going to type zero on the keyboard. And then I'm going to click key again. So now if I'm over here and I hit the number zero, boom, it's going to take me back to that locator. So that's good to know. Now let's take a look at this pad, because we're going to work it out a little bit. We're going to do a couple of pretty interesting things to it. It's long, and we don't have to worry about that, because it's like 10 minutes long. And you don't want a 10-minute pad in your set. It's too much. Plus, you might run out of pad, because sometimes people get long-winded and they keep going. So what I do instead is I actually grab a good portion of the pad, and for me, 8 bars is pretty good. So let's go ahead let's go ahead and take it out to 12. And I'm going to take this, and what I did was I clicked in the track. I'm clicking and holding, and I'm going to drag it right down there, right? Now I'm going to come over to help, because this is a great place to just look for commands instead of having to memorize them all the time. Because what I want to do here is I want to split, okay? So I'm going to type the word split, and then I'm going to click it. It's under the edit menu, split, or you can go Command E. You can see that right now on the screen. So I'm going to go split. And now what that does is, you can see, it splits that pad in two right there. I'm going to take this piece, highlight it, and delete it. I don't need that much. All I need is a little. You can see by looking at the waveform that the pad fades in. Let's just hear it. Right? So the pad is fading in, and about bar 3, it gets to full volume. Stop it. It abruptly stops, which is not ideal. So we're going to fix that. But for now, what I'm going to do is, since I know that by the beginning of bar 5, I have a pretty good, I have a full volume pad at that point. All right, so I'm going to put, I'm going to right click right here, and I'm going to add locator. And I'm going to name this locator loop point. And I'll explain why in a little bit. From there, I'm going to grab 4 good bars, 1, 2, 3, 4. So we can just let this thing loop for 4 bars. It's not a big deal. And at that point, that's when I'm going to use that last cue that we have. So let me show that to you. We're going to go back into our MIDI cue project, and here it is. That loop back is the last one. So I'm going to put the loop back cue at the beginning of bar 8, because this note, what's going to happen when we use this MIDI note is that when that note gets activated, it's going to tell Ableton that when you get to the end of this bar, which is right here, I want you to go back to the previous locator. And the previous locator is the next locator to the left, which in this case is loop point, right? So when we do that, and by the way, over here, this little arrow right here, that is go to previous locator. So we're going to teach this cue to do this activity. So now we will go ahead and start. We're going to go into MIDI mode. We're going to start it back up again, and then I'm going to hit this little arrow for go to previous locator. And then when it hears that note, it's going to save that. Okay, so here we go. We're hitting it. Going to hit go to previous locator. Got it. And boom. All right. Spacebar to stop. Note F sharp 3 is going to go to previous locator. Let's come out of MIDI mode. Shrink this down. We don't need to worry about it now. And now watch what happens. When this thing is playing and it hits that loopback cue, you're going to see that thing start to glow green. Boop, 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 and goes back again. So now this thing is going to loop forever unless we tell it not to anymore, which is very cool. And it goes right at the end of the bar. Now, if we were to loop out of this and go someplace else, that's a, again, that's a really abrupt stop, and we don't like that. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to use this awesome little thing that's built into Ableton under Audio Effects. So we're going to click Audio Effects, and we're going to come down to Reverb. This is a lot of steps, guys, I know, but it's going to be something that it'll become second nature to you. So I'm going to hit the Hall Reverb, and I'm going to hit Cathedral. This is a nice, big, boomy, crazy reverb. I'm going to drag it and drop it right onto that pad. Next thing I'm going to do is change the decay time. I usually change it up to about 10 seconds, and it usually defaults to 10.3. That's fine. It's not a big deal. The dry wet is up way, way hot. That's good. And then the last thing that we want to do to this pad is we want to actually, let's double click it so we could get the main control on it. And I'm actually going to bring it down to about minus 20 decibels because it should be quiet. It shouldn't be as loud as a track. It should be something that just kind of gently flows in the background. So we now have those pads in. And see how I lowered the volume last? The reason I did that is because now you can't really tell where the dynamics are the way you could before. So you want to save that step till last. And now you have a looping pad that, watch, when we're at zero and we begin, it's going to fade in nicely. We can hear that underneath of us now. Once it gets to, I just shrunk us down. Once it gets to the loop point, now it begins the loop. When it hits that loop back, see that? And boom, it goes back again. Can't tell. It's a seamless process, and you've only used up about 11 bars, and it's a very slim little thing that's going to keep you going as long as you need to. Now, if we needed to stop or if we needed to move on to another place, what happens now? See that? Because we added that reverb with that long tail. When we stop the track, now it shimmers out. It doesn't stop abruptly. So now you can do nice things with your pads and not worry about whether it's going to stop abruptly when you're done with it. All right, that, for all it's worth, is how you set up the beginning of a set. Now is the point, though, where we're actually going to start doing some crazy stuff. So now we're going to start bringing in songs. Before I do that, just this will make your life easier. I'm going to go ahead and dial this whole set up to 138 beats a minute. And that's not going to change anything except for the Ableton clock. It's just going to make it count faster. But the pad isn't going to change because it's not warped. It's regular. The reason I want that is because my first song happens to be 138 beats a minute. And it's just easier if we start it that way. Even though it has its own tempo track to master that and handle it, it's just something I usually do. So what we're going to do now, hear that nice fade out, is we're going to grab our first song. So let's go back into our songs. And we're going to grab Only King Forever. And that is ready to roll. It's right down here. It's usually like the .als file is the one that you want, not necessarily the thing at the top. So we're going to bring that into this drop files and devices here area, and then we're going to drop it. Okay. Now, what that does is it every time you drop something in Ableton, it puts it at the very beginning of the song. That's something you're just going to have to get used to, and it also expands everything. So the first thing that I usually do is I take it back down, hit the little collapse button, and I collapse everything down. And now I will go to the end of the song, and if it's too long, like we want to see it all at once, there we go. I'm going to come right here, and I'm going to click and hold right about here, and then I'm going to grab everything that there is in that song. And what we want to do at this point is we want to drag that stuff. I'm pinching out. We want to drag that stuff to where we want this song to start. And that's why I left a little bit of pad beyond the loop point, because if we go to like bar 12, we can, and I'll show you this. We'll drag that right there. That's good. 12 is a good spot for it. I'm actually going to take that pad, even though it's been deleted, I can still drag it back out here and let that pad continue until the intro of the song starts. And that just helps a little bit with preventing dead air and allowing everything to kind of go seamlessly. If it's not enough, like if you need a little bit more pad, just drag it out a little bit more. It's no big deal. For now, I think this is going to be fine. Now, this song is technically beginning right here at this count in, right? And I want to hear that count in. I want to hear all the things that come with it. So I'm going to right click on bar 12 and I'm going to say add locator. And we're going to let it be called one. And this is, I'm just going to call it only king. You can't put but so many letters in there, so you may as well make it nice and easy to read. So now we have only king forever inside. And the next thing that I want to do is I want to go back into our MIDI project, our MIDI cues, and I'm going to bring that click toggle in. Because whenever we get to the beginning of this, I want Ableton to go ahead and turn that click on for me. During hosting, that's, we don't need it. But when we get to that first song, we do need that click to turn on. So let's just watch this now. Let's check it out. All right, we got a pad. We just opened up. We got hosting happening, most likely. We hit the loop point. We got our electric guitar player playing some sweet swells. Everything's sounding good. We're looping as long as we want to. And the next thing that we're going to do is we're going to be ready to move to that first song. Now, how are we going to do that? I'm going to stop the track for right now. I use the foot pedal for that. And just like we use this loopback cue to go to the previous locator, I use the foot pedal to go to the next locator. And we can talk about how all that gets done with a pedal probably near the end or maybe in another video even. But for now, I'm going to do a key MIDI cue just like we did before. And I'm going to actually hit this and I'm going to type the number one. And that sets that up on number one. So as for now, while we have that pad going, whenever I'm ready to move to Only King, I'm just going to hit the number one and it'll go to Only King. On the pedal, what I actually do is I assign the go to next locator button. And that way, every time I push that button, it goes to the next locator. It's very useful to do it that way. But for now, you know, we're going to use this way. So now, when I'm ready to go to Only King, like maybe Amen is coming at the end of this prayer and it's time to get rolling. And I hear it and I'm like, all right, here we go. I hit the number one, boom. And at the end of that
one,
bar.
One, two, three, four.
See that? Pad fades out just as Only King starts. And there we go. We're in. We're into our first song. And we have our slides here,
intro,
but they're not going to be firing
in.
Because what we need to do is we need to tell Ableton over here in ProPresenter, we need to tell Ableton that Only King Forever is the first song in the playlist. And I talked about in my other video how you might have hosting here might be number one, or pre-service and then hosting, and then it could be that Only King Forever is the third item in your list. And if so, then you need to call it item three. But for our purposes right now, it's the first item in the list, so that's what we're going to call it. We're going to come over here. We're going to get into our playlist. We're going to drag item one over here. And now watch what happens when we hit. We're looping. We hit the pedal, and we go into this.
One, two, three, four.
And it fired that cue, and it moved us to the blank slide right here. Let's go ahead and skip ahead to where the verse begins.
Verse.
And our God and firm foundation. There we go. That's working. And that's going to work all the way through it for us. All right, so let's stop there. And basically, we're just going to see a lot of repetition at this point, which can't hurt. I think this will help you. I'm going to shrink this down because song one is set to go. And now we did talk about tempo tracks in the one song, and I told you that typically whenever I get to the end of a song, I actually drag that tempo track to end when the end cue comes, because if we're doing a seamless transition, then we want to let the new tempo track in the next song take over at that point. So that's the way we're going to set this up now. All right, let's go ahead and bring in our next song, and I'm going to shrink this all up so we have plenty of margin for that. Also, another, you know what, before we do that, though, at the very end of the song, if there's going to be some downtime between songs, then we can put the click toggle back up here again, and it'll turn the click off, because this is a big song. Only King Forever is a big song, and as it ends, we want to have a minute for the song to trail out a little bit. So what we'll do is, see, the click toggle turns the click off. You're jamming it out. The crowd's loving it. And then we'll start that next song right about here. We'll start the count off for it. And this is something you'll have to get a feel for. And this is going to be Canvas and Clay. All right. So now I have a second locator. While I'm thinking about it, I'm going to hit key. And I'm going to key in the number two there. That just lets me move around anywhere in the set just with the click of a single button. So let's go down. Let's grab our songs again. And let's bring in Canvas and Clay. That's our next trick here. So canvasandclay.als. We're going to drag it into here. Again, it's going to come. It's going to bring it to the front. It's going to expand everything. I'm going to hit this and shrink it back up. Go back to the beginning. And there it is. I see it's just dropped it right underneath of everything. So I'm going to take this down as small as I can so I can reach everything at once. And I'm going to grab all the things that come along with Canvas and Clay. And then I'm going to drag them out. And you can let it go and drag it again if you want. And I'm going to drag it out right to, whoops, let's just expand that so we can fit. I'm going to drag it to the start of Canvas and Clay. That has an item number in it already, and we will put our own item number in. So one thing we have to do is we need that click toggle right there. Since we turned it off right at the end of Only King, we're going to turn it back on at the beginning of Canvas and Clay, and that's a toggle switch, so it's like on, off, on, off. Now the next thing we need is we need our playlist cue for our slides, and we're going to use... Let's get back into those cues. Item number two. And let's make sure we know why we're saying that. Because there it is. Item number two is Canvas and Clay. So we'll be on Only King. We'll be on that last blank slide when that song ends. And then we'll let this little cue right here tell ProPresenter, all right, let's move to the next song. And then you'll be on that first blank slide as soon as you hit this. So that is, let's check the song and make sure everything's looking good, because we're changing the tempo, and sometimes Ableton does some funny things with these, and you have to kind of deal with it. We'll see if that happens. Now, if you remember, this is good because with Canvas and Clay, it actually has some time signature cues. And if you remember from when we were setting it up in the other video, the time signature changes to 2/4 for a bar and then back to 4/4. And I told you we needed to make these cues because these locators are not coming with the song. See how important this is now? You need these things. So what we're going to do is we're going to follow these time signature cues and make some adjustments real quick. So this one right here, this first one, is a 2/4 bar. I'm going to right click right where that is and insert time signature change. I'm just going to type 2/4. That makes that a 2/4 bar. It's simple and done. Then I'm going to move to here, the beginning of that next bar. And if you need to, let me just expand this. If you need to see, and now we need to come back and do another one to go back to 4/4 right here. And now we're all set. So let's go to the next one. And there it is. Insert time signature change, 2/4. The same thing goes for if you have a song that's in 6/8. You're going to have to change it for the whole song, and you'll just do that right where the locator is. And then here we're going to go back to 4/4. Let's find the rest. I think there's just one more. There it is right there, right here at the end. So we're going to do a time signature change, 2/4 for a bar, and then back. If you remember, we have to go back to 4/4 here, and I told you you could make a second track there if you wanted to, but I don't, so I deleted it. And I just have to remember that we go back to 4/4 here, so we can end it and everything looks normal at the end. I'm also going to take the tempo track and I'm going to drag it to the ending. And you'll see that that kind of wonks out some of this stuff because it may want to move it back to 138. But that's not a big deal. That's all details. And we'll sort that stuff out later. So now we have two songs in. And because we have a pretty quick transition, let's go ahead and get the clip. I'm going to turn it on because remember, this is a toggle. It's not on or off. It's just do the opposite of whatever it currently is. So we're going to watch the ending.
Ending.
All right. So we're jamming out, we're jamming out, we're jamming out. Everyone's loving it. And then...
One. Two.
Still trailing.
Intro. Two. Three. Four.
And now we're into canvas and clay. See that? If you want a tighter transition, you could slide this stuff backwards. But if you do, you would have to grab...
First.
If you wanted to do that, you would have to grab all this stuff just like we did before, right? And drag it backward. But if you do that, don't forget that your time signature cues are not coming automatically. So you're going to have to delete those or move them. And I would suggest for that purpose, don't put these in until you're sure that you have the song located where you want it. Another thing you could do, since you have that pad track, is you could put a pad in the key of B. You could just drop a piece of it right here and just let it go. The reason I didn't is because... there's going to be a lot of crowd participation right here at the end of this song. You're going to jam it out, and the people are going to be clapping. By the time this song starts, believe me, it's going to feel completely seamless. And that's the kind of thing you have to really get the feel for. So we have our first two songs done, and they're in, and there's really nothing we need to do, except if you're going to automate lights, but that's something that we're not dealing with just yet. So when we hit the end here of this song, we're actually going to go directly into our final song. And so I'm going to hit 3. I right-clicked on there and I said add locator. 3. And then our final song that we picked was Stand in Your Love. A big old crowd favorite. People love when this one kicks in. And that won't take very much time because you're going to go right into the intro of it right here at the end of this song. So now that we have the locator set for Stand in Your Love, it actually happens to be the same tempo anyway, so that's not going to be a problem for us. What I'm going to do is I'm going to shrink this whole thing down like we did before. Now you see this starting to take shape. Everything goes from top to bottom and left to right. When one song ends, the next song begins. And because we put together everything in this way, this collapsible format that I showed you, it's all like just a title rainbow, and it follows along very easily from the stage. So the last song that we're going to grab is Stand in Your Love. When we pull it down, remember, what's going to happen is there's the ALS. I'm going to drop it down to the drop files and devices, and it's going to do the same thing. It's going to put everything all funky. So I'm going to hit this collapse button. Everything collapses. We're going to grab it all the way to the tops of those slide cues. And sometimes, like, I would rather do as little dragging and dropping and dragging and dropping as possible. So I'm going to actually close for a minute, collapse this side. And now look at that. As long as I can grab a hold of something, I can pull this all the way, just about all the way to the spot. I'm going to use this and get this exactly where we need it. We don't need to kill or start the click here because that's going to take care of itself. We'll just let that continue to run. The only thing we need to do, we'll check this, make sure everything looks good. And it does. Everything looks good. All those cues are following along. And what we're going to do is open this back up again. And we're going to go into playlist. And we're just going to select item 3. There we go. So now that's going to tell ProPresenter that it needs to move to the third item in its list. And all that stuff should be working well. So just how this tempo track ends right here, literally this tempo track begins right here. And so one takes over for the other. And that works out quite nicely. So let's watch this transpire. I'm going to collapse everything like usual. And then let's just see the end here. Four bar is going to kick in. One,
ending.
Two. End.
Intro. Two. Three. Four.
See how that just goes real seamlessly right into the last song? and now everything's operating fine. And if we look at ProPresenter, we'll see that it's sitting on stand in your lower.
First, two, three, four.
And everything is working perfectly. And you can follow this stuff from start to finish. You can hook it up in your auditorium. You can watch it from start to finish. You can see all your slides. This is where it's quite rewarding because everything is down and you can just watch it go. All right, so we have three. I'm not going to belabor this. We've got three songs in. And now we just need to talk about what happens at the end, okay? What I tend to do is I try to continue the vibe that we have. And what we have here is 72 beats a minute, stand in your love kind of vibe. So assuming that there's something happening at the end of this song, let's just go ahead and plan that, because sometimes you may do two songs and then you might drop down and take some time for talk time. And that's not covered so far, so we're going to cover it now. We could use this pad track that we have up here, but instead I'm going to actually just continue our, I'm going to insert an audio track and I'm going to continue our top to bottom approach. But I will keep the color coding because that makes it easy. And we'll call this pad two. And this could be, you know, like your generosity time. It could be anything. The external out is going to be set to two, just like all the other stuff. And one thing we want to do here at the end of this song, let's go ahead and just add a locator. We'll just call it talk time. You can call it whatever you want to. And I'm going to, one thing I'm going to do is grab it in my MIDI cues and I'm going to get my click toggle and I'm going to stop the click. Now, you may not want to stop the click because if you're going to have your band continue to play, like maybe the band's going to continue to play the stand in your love progression while this talk time happens, just leave the click running because then they'll be tighter and you'll have a nice pad underneath of you. But what we're going to do is, since the pad that we used at the way beginning was in the key of C and it's all treated perfectly, we're going to copy that with a command C. And then I'm going to bring that same pad because we're still in the key of C now. We went to B, but now we're in C. And I'm going to come to the end of the set and I'm going to drop that thing right there. Okay? So now we have the second pad and we can check it. We can see it's at minus 20. And let's see if it's... Okay, it did not retain the audio effect. So we're going to go back to audio effects, get that cathedral reverb again and drop it back in, raise that up to the 10, around 10 seconds. That way when that's going, that it trails out nicely for us. And we'll go ahead and just bring this out some more too, just so that it gives us all that we need. The reason that click kept going is because I didn't let it hit the toggle. Now if it hits the toggle,
in two, three,
see that thing go
four.
Away. Boom. And you hear that pad kick in? Now we're seamlessly into talk time. It's no problem. So at that point, we're going to let the pad get up to full volume. It's there about now, right here. So this is a good place for us to add a locator for our loop point. There's our loop back cue. We have one, two, three, four bars. When you begin that fourth bar, you want to go ahead and put that loop back cue in there. That way, this same loopback cue that you used before, it knows to go back to the previous locator. Watch. And that's going to loop forever for you until you're done with it. Now, at this point, whenever you're done with this pad, if you are using a pedal, because we already programmed in a stop cue, if you're using a pedal, you can hit the stop button, and it's going to stop, and your reverb trail is going to help you out there. Now, if you are going to do some other things, like if you want Ableton to launch a message bumper or something else for you, a video, and change the lights, it can do all those things, and we do that on the regular. Then what you could do is you could use the go to next locator, and you would have another locator here that takes you to that next point. And sometimes I do that, even if I don't, like if I don't want to reach up and hit the stop button, I'll just use this for, you know, call it message. And if you put the stop cue in there, then it basically takes care of business for you. So if you set, let's go into key and set this message. Let's just put a number 9 in there. We're not using that one. And we're looping, as soon as I hit that number 9, even no matter where this is, see, it's going to loop back, it's going to do its thing. As soon as I hit 9, when it gets to the end of that bar, it's going to go right to there, and it stops. See? So that right there in, wow, just a little over maybe 40 minutes or so, is that is going to give you a better set than you might have ever had before. And I hope that that's what it does, because what we have here is a completely seamless set that starts with music, a warm pad. It goes seamlessly into your first song, takes you seamlessly into the second song, into the third, drop down to talk time. And remember, this could be anywhere. You could move these things around and you can add some stuff. And just like we went forward to the message with that go to next cue, we could have done that in the middle of the set too and set it to where it hovers in this pad and it loops forever until you hit that go to next button. And then it starts the next song, turns the click on for you and does the thing. So if you have questions, that's cool. That's great. I'm happy to answer them. What I typically do at this point, if this was going to be my set from top to bottom, is that I'll make sure every single thing in it is fully collapsed. I'll bring it out to here, and I will shrink it down pretty well. If I want to be able to see, because you can see these white markers, if I want to be able to see those as I go, I can see the whole set right now. But if I want to be able to actually see those markers and know what they are, like here's verse, here's chorus, then I'll maybe expand it out about like that. And then when we start, we come from at the end of our countdown, and here we go. We're off to the races. We're doing our thing. We're looping. We're doing our hosting. We're having some prayers and stuff. And then when we're ready to go to Only King, we go.
One, two, three, four.
ProPresenter says, oh, we're in Only King. It goes to Only King for you. And it's going to take you all the way to the end. When you're ready to move to the, when you're at the end of Only King and you're going to the second song.
Ending.
Kills the click for us. Trails out. Next song
one.
Is beginning. See that?
Two.
It's already knowing that we're in canvas and
intro.
Clay.
Intro. Two.
Hit slide one
three,
right now.
Four.
And boom. We're in the blank for that. It's going to take us all the way
intro.
To the end of that song. When we get to the end of this song.
Tag.
To the exact right slide.
Ending.
Knows what slide. And now we're in Stand In Your Love.
Intro. Two.
As soon as we
three,
hit that intro.
Four.
Boom. We're in the blank and we're ready to roll. When that ends, you could actually
end.
Have another
two,
item.
Three, four.
Boom. We're done. Once this pad kicks in and it's talk time, you could have another item that changes your slide automatically and it gives you a verse that you want to go through, or it shows you a slide that you need to talk about. There's literally no limit to what you can do with Ableton Live. And I hope that in these first couple of videos, what I've helped you with is some start to finish explanations so that you can literally watch these things from top to bottom, and that it will help you build from absolutely nothing a complete set that will do exactly what you want it to in Ableton. You can change your tempos, you can turn on your click, turn off your click, set your locators, change time signatures, and have a very nice, buttery smooth set from start to finish with full automation. Thank you so much. I'm really glad that you have gotten this far. That's really terrific. A lot of people don't know this much about Ableton, and you just made yourself a heck of a lot more valuable. So congratulations. I look forward to hearing from you. Let me know your successes, your failures, like when you want to rip your hair out, and ask questions, because that's what I'm here for. I've been doing this for a while, and I wish some of these tutorials had been around for me when I got started. And I wish that for you now, and now you don't have to wish it anymore. So enjoy those, and do stay in touch.
If you made it this far, you have graduated. Congratulations. You've built an entire Ableton set from start to finish. There's no limit to where you can go from here. So make sure you go ahead and like this and subscribe, hit the bell so you can see more as it comes. And let me know in the comments what else I might be able to help you with. And I'll see you around.